Well, thank you for coming to my session. My name is Stefan Janssen, and this is going to be like an emotional roller coaster of what I've been experiencing for the last 4 or 5 months. So it's basically a use case about using PrimeNG and other technologies and trying to get that on production. So basically a use case. For the people who don't know me, maybe this morning wasn't completely clear. So I'm basically the founder of DevOx. I started this 17 years ago. As you can see from the gray hair, this side is from organizing events, and this is from my wife, the other side. And I also co-founded Voxt, and Voxt is basically an incubator for Java user group events who want to eventually become a DevOx. So it's like a growing path. And I also co-founded, because of my son, DevOx for Kids. And DevOx for Kids is like, it's worldwide. Every weekend there are multiple events taking place, trying to inspire children in IT and engineering. And because of that, I'm a Java champion, but I'm also a day-by-day passionate developer. I'm not the best developer, but I'm very passionate about it. And I tweet a lot on Stefan007. So what's the agenda? Well, I want to first give you a bit of a context of the objective, then I'll give you some experience about the development and how I actually approached it, and then I'll do the design and the deployment coverage. And you might notice the order isn't actually correct, because normally you would do the design and then you might be doing development, so I'll explain that. And for this, it's a journey. So I've asked Mr. Robot to actually join me, and he will actually, I found, so because he has a very expressive face, I've asked him to actually express my emotions throughout the different phases. So that's where you're going to see him appear on the different slides. So the first objective was the following. We, in DevOx, we have 6 DevOxes, and each DevOx has a call for papers. So it's called the CFP. And in the CFP, people can actually rate, or not in the CFP, but the CFP is linked to a mobile app, and the mobile app, the attendees are there, when they're authenticated, they can actually rate a talk. So they can say, wow, this was a great talk, they even can give comments, and so on, but it's fragmented. DevOx France has their own CFP, DevOx UK has their own CFP, and so on. And what I wanted to do is create like an aggregator where I could get all the ratings into one location, and then we could see who are the top speakers, who are the speakers which still have to learn a lot, etc. And so that was basically the first use case. The other one was also to import the talks. I wanted to get all the talks, of course, because if you have the ratings, you need to see the talks as well. So that way, in the program committee, if like Alex organizes Vox Days Bucharest, he says, well, I've got this talk. Has that speaker already spoken at other DevOxes? So he or she can actually search. Ah, yeah, he has already spoken. There's the YouTube link, and the ratings were 5 out of 5. Yeah, we should definitely schedule that person. So that was a bit the setup of the first version of my project. And this was in November. So this was in November last year. And so, hey, let's do some development. I was like very confident. I was like, yeah, development, that's what I do. That's what I brief. That's what I dream of. That's what I do day in, day out. So that shouldn't be a problem. So a very confident Mr. Robot. And I heard a lot of things about J-Hipster. Now, just out of curiosity, anybody already doing or using J-Hipster? Okay, who has never heard about J-Hipster before? Who has not heard about it? Only a few, okay. So you're gonna learn a few things. I know Julien Dubois, he's one of the founders of J-Hipster, so I said, well, I really want to just play with your technology, because also as a conference organizer, you wanna play with technology, you wanna see what's hot, what's not, and then also invite these people to your event so they can talk about it and hopefully inspire your attendees. So the cool thing about J-Hipster is you saw the opening keynote from Mark Heckler this morning. He was like making in 45 minutes a microservices environment. Well, with J-Hipster, I can do the same what he did in 5 minutes, more or less. And it's a generator. It basically generates code based on selections that you make in the generator wizard. And the wizard is just text-based, so you can see here on the slide, you can, for example, the first thing it asks is that what type of application do you want to build? Do you want to build a monolith, or do you want to build microservices? And so because it was version 1, I said, I'll just write a monolith that's easy to maintain and to deploy. I did want to play with some new technology, which is KeyCloak. And KeyCloak is this OAuth, authentication authorization environment from Red Hat. It's open sourced, which allows me to actually, I mean, my ultimate dream is to have like a single sign-on for all the DevOxes and VoxDays and have it all centralized, right? So I definitely wanted to have KeyCloak in the mix. And then for the front end, you can actually select multiple strategies. Just recently, or they're working also on the React version. But at the time when I chose it, I wanted to learn Angular, not AngularJS, but the new Angular 4. This is a screenshot from last week, so they already support 5. But at that time, I selected Angular 4 because I wanted to learn from this. So that's basically what you do. You select these different, or you answer these different questions. And then it basically produces a lot of code. It produces both the server and the client side, and it's all based on best practices. So if you don't know, for example, Angular, it will create a prototype for you in a matter of minutes and showing you all the best practices. And that's like learning by example. I mean, that's what I like, is that, sure, you can read some books, but if you look at the codes, that's where the truth is, and you look at how it's structured and so on, and it was really inspiring. So it produces that, and then of course the next, because that's only the prototype, you just have some administration of users, and that's it. There are no entities. So what JHipster has, again, to bootstrap you really fast, is something called design entities, which is the fourth selection on the left. This is, by the way, JHipster online. It takes you step by step. So you can actually, what I'm doing in the command line, you can also do it in the browser. It links it to your GitHub account, and whatever it produces, it actually pushes it into your GitHub repository. And so that's what I really like, is that it has this interface definition language, or like it's like UML, a class diagram. And it basically asks you, hey, what is your domain model? So which entities are you going to be using? And so in my case, I had presentations, I had users, I had events, I had tracks, and so on. And what you can do, not only that, is that you can also define the relationships. So again, if you've been doing UML, it looks very familiar. But the beauty with this one is that this UI, so you basically edit on the left, and you just type, and you type the entity, you type the relationships, and on the right, it will visualize basically what you're wanted to achieve. And this creates an XML file. And this XML file can then actually be used in the generator to generate all the create, remove, update, and delete pages for your domain environment. And this is done just by this one line, JHipster, import JDL, and then the file that you've basically have exported from the browser. When you hit enter, it basically produces all the entities. It not only creates the entities in the backend, but it also creates all the screens, all the Angular screens, to edit in a very simple way the different contents. So this is like great. I mean, if you then look at the example app, well, this you have this default welcome page where you can log in. When I click on login, it will redirect me to KeyCloak. You have to configure KeyCloak, of course, with users and permissions and so on. Once you're authenticated, it uses the JWT to actually pass that token, that authentication token, into your application. And you're authenticated, you can start using the environment. And this is, again, a matter of minutes. I mean, in less than half an hour, I had you do tweaks, of course, on the domain model because you forgot some fields, and then you want to add some more things, of course, so it's a bit of an iterative process. But very, very rapidly, you actually have a working prototype. So it produces like this screen automatically for the users, so you can actually edit the users. And this was like one of the examples that it creates, because every DevOps, every VoxDays has a track. So you have like the mobile apps, you have security, you have server-side Java, and so on. So I entered in the diagram a track, and it basically then generates this screen for you. So you get a list of all the tracks, and you can edit a track, delete a track, and you can also search a track. Now the search is only added because I selected Elasticsearch in the generator. Because in the generator, you can actually say what type of plugins you want to use in your system. And if you say, yes, I want to have Elasticsearch, then it will automatically add search bars in front of all of your domain objects. Yeah. Now, the problem with Elastic, well, it's not free for starters, at least if you put it in production. But it's also like a bit heavy if you just want to search on names. I mean, then that's a bit overkill, in my opinion. So I soon realized that wasn't really needed. And I basically factored that out using query by example. So that whole search thing was basically replaced with a few lines of code, which is the query by example is based from the Spring Data project. And by the way, I did not mention that, but the server-side generation, it's all based on Spring Boot. So what you saw this morning from Mark, that's actually already generated. And that's the beauty, is that it generates a lot of code, but it really is like, again, learning by example. You really then see how you actually have to use this by the professionals who know it inside and out. So I replaced that on the server side by query by example, but then of course I'll probably factor that out as well once I learned a few other things. So for example, one more complicated form, so to speak, is the editing of a presentation. So a presentation can have one or more speakers, and I also want to have multiple tags because I want to be able to actually group the content on tags. And so I was having fun. This was now already, it was December, so DevOps Belgium was behind me. I could relax and really do some quality time hacking. And I was like playing with Angular and even with jQuery a few things, and I was like, oh, okay. And then I was showing this to Alex during a hangout. I said, Alex, I'm really having fun, and this is going to be useful for you as well. And the first thing he said was like, PrimeNG. I said, damn, yeah, okay. And of course I knew about it, but I didn't know that you already had an Angular component, so I didn't look at it. And so when Alex mentioned that, I was like, okay, I went to the website, and damn. I spent like a couple of days writing my own autocomplete, and he just has that, you know, that component is there. And it was a lot more nicer than the code I wrote. I mean, I'm a Java developer, I'm not a TypeScript developer. I must say, I'm not a JavaScript developer. TypeScript is much closer to Java, and I'm really feeling like very at home in both Java and TypeScript these days. But I discovered PrimeNG because of Alex, and I was like, wow, it has an autocomplete. Great. You know, I'll just add it. And it was really very, very simple to do so. You know, at the top, it basically adds the P autocomplete. You add a complete method where you basically are searching for speakers, for example. And that search itself can then actually go to your backend, get a JSON file based on the letters that you've entered, and it gets basically displayed in the view. It was like very, you know, very clean, very fast to actually adjust my code. But the problem was jhipster does not produce PrimeNG; it produces Bootstrap components. So because of Alex's suggestion, which was great, but I was like, damn, okay, now I need to like rewrite all the tables, I need to do all the different components, and you know, that took me, again, a couple of days. I know there was like a really cool data table, which I looked at, and this was before the Turbo table, because the Turbo table was still in beta, so it's like, okay, I'm not gonna do the beta yet, I'll just stick to the, you know, the stable one. So I played with the table, and I was like blown away. I was like, come on, I mean, this table, and I'll show you in the application, this table already has search and filtering and all of that. So you remember the query by example I had on the server side? Well, you know, we're not talking about millions of records, we're talking about a few hundred maximum. And sure, talks, we have like 1,400 talks a year, so it adds up after a while, but in the beginning, I was just, well, let's get all the data from the server into the client, and then the client does local search on the data in the browser. So I could actually even remove all the code for searching by example on the server and just have PrimeNG do this for me. And the beauty is that, like here, I did move the ratings. So the ratings is white, so you don't see bad ratings. But what I can now do is that I can filter and say, okay, give me all the talks from Mark Reynolds, and give me all the talks from Mark Reynolds and DevOps US. And I just type in those fields in the head of the columns, and I can actually do some really sophisticated filtering. I can even say, give me all the talks from Mark Reynolds and DevOps US who had a rating more than 4. And then, or give me all the talks with more than four and who have Kubernetes in the title, and pff, it's instantly there. Of course, what I've done now is that because you don't want to get that data constantly backwards and forwards, I'm basically storing the data in local storage. So you can even work with the admin, I call this now the administrator. I can work with the administrator even offline, so I can query and see what speakers have what ratings, etc. And it's like, wow, I was like really being productive. I was like, Christmas was coming close. I was like, yeah, I'm feeling really good here. I then started thinking of other things. So we have all these call for papers. And one of the things that Mark Hazel, who runs DevOps UK, was already hinting is that if you want to configure the CFP, you need to configure the schedule. So you need to say what's happening on day one and day two, how many rooms you have, and so on. And so on a rainy weekend, I discovered also the schedule application or the schedule component from PrimeNG, which uses the full calendar underneath, which is a JavaScript component. And it allows me to actually create the schedule of DevOps in a WYSIWYG type of way. So I can like right click on a day. I can say, okay, this is a conference talk and it's happening in this and that room. And it then creates a time slot on my schedule. And this time slot is then used to actually schedule the talks. So I was like really doing some cool stuff. Again, Alex helped me in deploying this on production because it was working locally, but it was not running on production, on staging. And what Alex discovered, I mean, he's much smarter than me, is that the JIT compiler was actually breaking the system. So actually I had to turn off the ahead of time compiler from Angular to get the schedule working. So there's something happening there, but that's probably a different story and a talk on its own. So fine, the development was done. I really felt very positive. Now for the deployment. And I'm not a DevOps guy, I'm a developer. I don't really do DevOps. So my mindset was a bit like this. I was nervous. I was like, okay, I need to deploy this. What should I do? And luckily again, both Alex offered like, you know what? We'll spend a few evenings together on Zoom. Andra will not mind. And we were basically screen sharing and he was guiding me and I was learning a lot on really just deploying this beast onto an EC2 instance. And what's nice, what we discovered is that JHipster actually also produces a complete Docker structure. So you have actually YAML files for all the different applications that it is dependent on. So you will see you have a key cloak, you have MySQL there, you have Hazelcast, which is using that for caching. And then you have just a Docker Compose, which starts all these instances for you. So you can do this with the app.jaml file, and that creates basically your complete environment. So that was like, well, this is looking good. The first thing we ran into that Tuesday evening was that Keycloak, which does the authentication, it only works in production using SSL. You need to have a certificate because it's doing authentication, authorization, it should be secure, right? So as I was looking at Let's Encrypt, I said, oh, we'll just do Let's Encrypt and that's fine, I don't have to pay for it. But then Alex came again with a suggestion with Cloudflare. So basically Cloudflare, anybody doesn't know Cloudflare? Everybody knows the Cloudflare? Oh, there's a few who don't. But Cloudflare, it has a free plan. And in the free plan, it provides a proxy where it actually creates an SSL certificate for you, but it also does caching. So it actually sits between the user and your website, and it does quite a bit of smart enhancements for you, including the SSL certificates. So that was already one problem solved. Then, of course, we started looking at continuous deployment and integration. And there again, GitLab was like, wow. I mean, I was on GitHub. The problem with GitHub is that if you want to have a private repository, because I didn't want to immediately open source this, because I was learning a lot, and then it was the code that would be refactored quite often as well. And with GitHub, if you have a private repo, you have to pay based on the number of private repos. With GitLab, you get private repos free of charge. So I was like, well, okay, Alex, thanks. Let's do GitLab, created private repos, free of charge, and it even has a continuous integration part in it. So you can actually then link it, because it does not only have private repos, it even has Docker registries as well. So you can actually push a change, it will actually get your code from GitLab, and then it will actually create a Docker file, push it in its registry, and then you can push that image basically to your container. And this is done using one file that you need to add to your project, which is called GitLab CI for continuous integration. And it has a few parts. The first part is not really necessary, but it's definitely worth adding, which it basically adds a cache to your repository. So everything of your repository is cached once. So the first time it runs your Maven file, it will actually download the internet, put it in the cache, and then the next time you run it, it will just take the cache. So it's going to be a lot faster. And then you have different stages of your build. You have the different dependencies, the build itself, the package, and the deploy. And every stage can be configured, as you can see, in these different blocks. You can tell them on which GitLab branches you're working. And then basically, it does this is the backend, by the way. It creates the Docker image for the backend. So you just have a maven minus prod clean package. And then once that's done, it will actually deploy that image onto your EC2 instance, in my case. That was it. So it very straightforward. I was able already to actually, you know, whenever there were new changes, I could actually build it, create an image, push the image to EC2, and then I could start it, for example, with, and that's on the next slide, here to staging, where I'm saying, like, okay, on staging, basically start, go to the Docker Compose directory, put it down, put it up again, and Docker Compose is basically running your container. That was like, wow, and we did that like in one evening. And I was like, yeah, I was like really feeling buzzed. And I was like, this is good. And yeah, you can just add more, like if you have, you could say like, okay, deploy to production, and then you can just have different commands. Now, of course, in production, I don't think you want to do a down and up, because that was making me a bit nervous. Because if on production you put your system down, there's like, you want to have rolling updates, right? You don't want to have your system down for 5 minutes because you're updating a new version. So this is definitely, I'll come back to that point later on, is not the way to do it in production environments. And in GitLab, this is basically your continuous integration dashboard. So they talk about pipelines, and many other vendors are doing the same, like CloudBees has like also different solutions there. Atlassian has the same. So everybody's working with these pipelines, which allows you to actually do some processing, and the output becomes the input for the next pipe in your process. And so here you have an example of the different builds that have happened. And on the right, you have this play button. And it's that play button, when you click on it, where you can say, OK, deploy to staging or deploy to production. So that's, for the moment, is still a manual thing, because I wanted to control the flow of deployment within my environment. Now, OK, we have an EC2 instance. We have the different Docker containers running. Now we need to be able to hit it, because I was still missing a central part, which was HA proxy. So basically mapping the different domains to do the public IP. And again, with a bit of help, I was like laying in my bed after this long hangout with Alex, and I was like smiling all the way. I was like, yes, this is nice, this is running. But I did understand that this was staging. Right, because there were still a few things that need to be resolved, like high availability, rolling updates, and all of that. So I knew I wasn't there yet, but at least I had a staging environment that we could play with it. So I was like really buzzed. I was already doing hangouts with the other DevOps organizers. I said, look what I've built, and have a look at this. And the problem with these guys, a lot of them are developers, they bombard you with new ideas. And like Mark is like, wow, but yeah, okay, so we have this content, and we have Vox.com. So, but Vox.com is actually showing talks with the videos, and we are adding this manually in WordPress. Couldn't we just generate it based on the talks you already have, and not manually insert it? So when the Vox Days event is finished, you import the talks from the CFP, you go to YouTube to find the link, and then you publish it to Vox.com. yeah, I could probably do that. And then you have Vox Days. I'm manually adding all the Vox Days, but you already have these events. So can't you just publish all the events automatically? And you know, that's there, and you just link it to the CF. Yeah, I can do that. So I was like, okay, I showed them something, and all of a sudden, I had a few extra new projects on my hands. And I was looking at the system saying, okay, well, the Vox.com and Vox Days, they probably need to talk to the same backends, because that's where the data is. But it's user-facing, because the admin is just us. It's user-facing. Does that mean I probably need to think about design, because it needs to look cool and sexy, right? And there were a few other things that they were saying as well. I said, yeah, but you know, the CFP, everybody has their own instance. And every CFP, somebody changes something here. In Poland, they do something there. And we have a fragmented version of our CFP application, which is open sourced. So they said, like, maybe you could also deploy, I'll go back one slide, sorry. You could also deploy a CFP. So the administrator allows you to create an event, add the schedule, and then say, create now the CFP. And it should be like a white label Docker instance where it gives the properties of the event, and then the CFP is actually configured based on that property file. And that way we only have one white label version, and we customize it with the properties that we inject. So that was like, okay, well, yeah, I think we can do that. So those were like three different projects just with having a hangout with these guys. But now I had to go for the design. So I had to design Vox.com and Vox Days. And when a developer is asked to do design, I think that's how you feel, right? You go like, I'm not a GUI guy. I don't, you know, how should I do this? I know how to develop, but design, that's for the guys with, I won't stereotype, but that's a different breed of person, right? So I started thinking about this, and what we often do for the DevOps websites, we use WordPress. The majority of them use WordPress. And in WordPress, you have these themes. So you can like go and buy a theme like for $45, and you have a really nice looking theme, responsive and all of that, and you just have to fill in the gaps. And I basically was first looking at that type of approach. I said, okay, I'm gonna select a cool theme to present lots of data, and then I will just extract the CSS and the HTML and so on and do that. And then basically map it to Angular. I did that like for one day and had like, I didn't know Angular well enough to do it good enough. And I soon actually dropped and said, okay, no, that's not gonna work. And then after searching the web a bit, I actually ran into something called Webflow. Don't know if you know this, but Webflow is it's basically allowing you to do WYSIWYG editing of also themes. So they also have proprietary themes. So I bought a theme which was like $50, and then you can actually link that content onto the data, test data that you put into their system. And then you can play with like a quick prototype with real data, but locally. And then once you're happy, you just save the HTML templates, and I use those templates to actually then angularize that website. And not being a designer, I showed what I did with the prototypes, and guys were like, wow, Stefan has like secret skills, you know. But I didn't tell them that actually it was based on a theme that I bought. Now I've spoiled it, of course. Now Alex knows, so he will have less respect for me. But I didn't want to be dependent on the Wi-Fi, so I just did a screen sharing, and it looks like really nice. You know, you can click on an event like Bucharest, you can import the dates, you can go to the next event, which is Minsk after this, and then you can go even to the next one, Singapore, you have a drop-down, you can go to the different events, so you have DevOps, Vox Days, and Java User Groups events. You can actually then go to the DevOps events as well, so I'll replace DevOps.com with this. And then you can also look at the champions, remember the ratings? So I can get the best rated speakers, and the guys from NoFly or FlyZone are here as well, but like Venkat, he's like the rock star. And then you get all the talks from Venkat that he has presented at different DevOpses, and you can basically see his talk there, and then go into Vox.com, which is the content part where it's all categorized. You get all the different content. I was into Kubernetes, so you can search out Kubernetes, get all the talks from Kubernetes, then click on a talk and basically see the YouTube video and watch it. So we have now Vox Days linked with DevOx, and they're all interconnected. And that's the next part. I can also then generate a CFP, and it's like becoming one ecosystem of all these, for the moment, fragmented events are now basically interconnected, which is like, yeah, cool. I'm a happy camper. So if you remember the setup here, I started to run into, let's say, issues, or I started to see opportunities in the fact that these were all monoliths. But I actually had some opportunities to actually externalize and introduce some microservices. So after some thinking, I said, well, you know, I wanted to know a bit about all the buzz about microservices. So I said, like, you know what, I'll just redo my monoliths and probably migrate it gently into a microservices environment. And soon what I realized after also talking to different people is that my monolith is basically a macro service, which I can eventually start chopping in different pieces. Like, for example, there's a small part for image processing. So when you add a talk or add an event, I can add a picture of the event, and then I'm actually creating multiple sizes of that image so that I can use the smaller image if it's on a mobile phone, or use the bigger image if it's on a desktop, and then I'm saving it that in Amazon S3. Well, that service could be perfectly extracted out of the monolith and create a microservice out of that, right? But there are other things, like the one in the middle there, you see the microservice between the two macros. This is my Docker spinner. So that one creates a new Docker CFP instance every time, saying like, okay, create a CFP for me. Now, we were having a chat at the speaker reception yesterday evening, and the guy from Amazon said, like, well, the problem with these microservices is that you're paying for the microservices when it's running, and it's running constantly. But if you only need it like 12 times a year because you're starting a new CFP for 12 events, for example, you only need it when you start it. So he already suggested, like, just turn that microservice into a serverless component. And so the serverless component is only built when it is running. So, you know, so what you're seeing basically, it's a hybrid solution. You are basically trying to get the best of both worlds. I mean, I'm not Deutsche Bank. You know, I don't have enough money to like have thousands of microservices and have it all. I mean, we're a small team, and every dollar is, you know, we need to earn it. So you want to be also a bit conscious about the resources you're using. And so if you can optimize it, why not do so? So my next plan, definitely, well, first of all, after this talk, I'll probably use Redux in the Angular clients. I've already had the workshop this morning, so that's an improvement. But I will also chop the monolith in different microservices so I can reuse certain things. And, you know, it's a constantly evolving beast, a hybrid beast, so to speak. Now, JHipster supports microservices, and it does it in an interesting way. It has a registry, as you saw this morning, where you have the Eureka server and the config server. Remember, this is all based on Spring Boot. And in the gateway, which is the front end actually has a Zool proxy and a ribbon interface or proxy, basically, which does the client-side load balancing. So every gateway, the Vox.com, VoxDays, and the admin, have this type of setup. The application I had written was written in a monolith. So I actually had to redevelop it and start selecting it from within the generator as a microservice. So the terminology in JHipster is that you have a gateway or you have a microservice. Microservice is on the back end, so it has no UI, and the gateway is the front end, which has a UI. Yeah? And then there you can actually select the service discovery, so you select the JHipster registry, you select Keycloak again, and basically it starts generating your different components within that environment. So it was basically a rewrite of a lot of boilerplate code, but my entities, remember the class diagram, I could just reuse, import it, and that was all fine. So, but now I have a microservices environment, and I need to do a second deployment. And I was feeling confident. I was like, well, you know, we did the first deployment. I know how this now works. Let's do this. This is going to be easy. Well, it wasn't really. First of all, you remember I'm starting these Docker instances for the different CFPs, and every CFP needs to have their own domain name. And the guys from DevOps Morocco actually helped me with this. And they said, we're going to use Traffic, because Traffic does some really crazy stuff. It not only can create certificates on the fly, it actually talks to Let's Encrypt on the fly and creates the certificates for you for every domain that you add to the environment. But you can also, it basically can replace HA proxy and do this all for you. Okay, I've never heard about Traffic before. Well, I heard it in some slides, but I've never played with it. They're actually based in France, so that's really nearby from a time zone perspective. And so I said, I was reading the documentation of Jay Hipster, and Jay Hipster's documentation said, please note that Traffic only works with console. So this cannot work if you're using Jay Hipster registry. And I was reading this on Friday. So that basically meant I had to redevelop the application and not select Jay Hipster registry, but use console. And console is also like, it's like a competitor of the Eureka service. So it was like Friday refactoring. I said, well, okay, it's almost weekend. I'll just do this in one day and I'll be fine. And the first thing I did is that I'll do it manually. I'll just factor out Eureka, put in console in, and after 4 or 5 hours, it was clear that wouldn't work, okay? So I took a shower, thought a bit about this. I said, okay, well, I will have to redeploy it, regenerate it using console. There's nothing, you know, there's no response. There's no alternative. Julien, the founder of JHipster, he did reply. He said, well, Stefan, Traffic works with Eureka. It does actually work. So it is just doable, but I just didn't have time to actually add it as a subgenerator. Oh, damn, okay. So it's like this dilemma, like, oh, shit, so what? And this is like, you know, new components. I didn't really know how they worked. So it's like, what should I do? You know, what's the step? So I was like, oh man, this was like Friday evening. My wife, she already saw immediately what's going on because I was running like, oh man, this is, you know, and I don't want to start weekend like that. So I said, relax, you know, just relax, have a look, think about it, just go out, go with the dog and you'll come up with some new ideas. And so I decided basically to regenerate it again. And now instead of selecting the registry, there is this option, select console as your as the alternative for your service discovery. And this was like after, I think, a couple of days, I had it working. And I was like, yes, finally. And this is not development anymore. This is really like tweaking and changing things and configuring and so on. And what you see on the left is that I have console, which is basically showing you the microservices in the discovery, which is available. And on the right, you have Traffic showing all the different endpoints and how it actually links to your service. And I was like, yes, did it. But what I didn't think about on the left in the blue corner there, this is the Traffic configuration file. It has a front-end rule where it says you take the path prefix and then you suffix it with the service name. So to visualize it, it has something like this. I had a slash voxt, which is talking to the backend. I had a slash voxt days and a slash console on that domain name. But I actually had to try to map these to, and these were like this is staging domain names, beta.vox.com had to map to slash voxt and so on. And I told Alex about the challenge, and Alex said, no problem, HA proxy, we'll figure it out, it's gonna work. And so he was already taking a bit more time with the HA proxy, and it actually worked until we used the authentication key cloak. So when we were going to key cloak, it was actually giving the old URL, the slash voxt, and not the voxt dot, not the beta.voxt.com, but it was giving you the domain name slash voxt. And so the authentication didn't work. And we go like, bloody hell. And so we had to actually drop HA proxy because it wasn't playing nice with the SSL certificates and the host forwarding and all of that shit that we were trying to solve. So I was like really frustrated. This was already like 1 week later. Like this was like Friday or Thursday, the week before that I decided to actually use console. So I was like, man, this is not really good. I was complaining to Julien, the guy from JHipster, and Julien said, you know what, I'll introduce you to the founder of Traffic. And the founder of Traffic is Emil Vogue. And Emil Vogue on Twitter said, you know what, Julien, one of my team, another Julien from my team, he's gonna get back to you this afternoon and you can do a hangout and he probably will figure it out. And that, this is like, you know, where it really makes such a big difference when you have experts on the line, on the, like a help desk. We basically had a 1 hour hangout, and he basically showed me how I had to configure my existing Eureka environment. So he actually said, get rid of console. Okay. Luckily, I had branches. Yeah. Get rid of console, go back to Eureka, and I'll show you what you need to add to the Docker YAML files to get traffic working nicely with your environment. And this is like really very valuable. So basically, the first thing he said is like, I will add a front-end rule, which is the host, and then actually the domain name that you want, in this situation, admin.vox.com. You enable it to actually work together with traffic, and you tell traffic which port it is listening on. And that was basically it. And in addition, I just want to give you this as an extra information, to enable HTTPS directly and to enable the certificates, those are the two red blocks that you need to add. So on the buff, you say, okay, I'm listening on HTTPS and HTTP. I will do redirects, all HTTPs will be redirected to HTTPS. And in the bottom, it's basically telling me, okay, well, save all the certificates from Let's Encrypt in my JSON file. And basically that magic happens now automatically. When I add a new domain name, it will actually go to Let's Encrypt, it will get the certificate, it will add it to my JSON file, so when you restart, it will still have that in the external storage. And it was like working. I was like, wow, this is magic. Now, the problem with magic is that you don't know what's happening behind it. So if something does go wrong, you have a tough job finding the problem. And I can even enable the dashboard from traffic, so it actually shows you all the mappings which is going on, and then the first one was the Docker link, because what traffic is doing, it's listening to the Docker sockets, and whenever there's a new Docker image, it says, there's a new Docker image, it goes and looks at the labels, and then it produces this mapping using the SSL certificates. So when you know how it works, it's simple, but just getting those stupid lines in the right order and getting all the properties working, that's always the challenge. So basically what I have now in my dashboard, on the left you can see I have beta.vox.com, it listens on HTTPS, and it maps it to that gateway microservice basically on the right. And yeah, I was like, yes, it works, great. So I was like really happy about that. And this was like already 4 months later when I started. And if you look at it, this is a bit like how actually now the architecture looks like. You know, it starts to get really impressive. You know, I got Angular and PrimeNG, I got traffic, I got Keycloak, everything is Dockerized. I got MySQL for my single sign-on, I got MySQL for my microservices, I'm using Spring Boot, using Hazelcast for caching. Great. All good. And I started adding more components like this, where I have a spinner now, which is going to be a serverless component. I have my Docker CFP, which is using Elastic and Redis, because you want to search on presentation using Redis. I got my image service, which is now a microservice. So this is like, this is all cool. And this is like running on one machine. So the next thing is like, shit, but you know, how, if I, now I want to do rolling updates, you know, I want to be able to scale this and so on, how will I do this? And yeah, okay, so it's like, shit, so I'm not there yet. This is not yet production, this is staging, because I'm unable to actually get a new version up there without having the other images going down. And so I was talking to different people that I know, and I basically have two options. Either I use Docker Swarm, or I use Kubernetes. Now, this is almost last slides. Docker Swarm, I've been told, you can't actually run it locally if you're on a plane or on a train and you have no internet and you want to test it locally. It's a bit more difficult to actually run Docker Swarm on a test or development environment. With Kubernetes, you have Minikube. So in Minikube, you can just start a Kubernetes cluster on your machine, and you can actually play with the pods and the masters and so on locally and actually test it until you actually push it to the production. So I'm probably going for Kubernetes. And then I was tweeting about this, and then all of a sudden the guy from Keycloak, he said, yeah, but traffic, you shouldn't go for traffic. You should probably go for Istio and go for service mesh. Because service mesh, you know, it removes all of these load balancer, client load balancers. It even removes Eureka, because Istio, it does it all for you. It's like this, it's based on Envoy product from Lyft. And it seems that Lyft and Google and IBM have joined forces to create this very interesting proxy where it actually runs as Docker instances, and you, the microservices, they just talk normally to each other, but they're intercepted. So all the HTTP calls are intercepted by Istio, and it does all the load balancing and all the magic for you. As a result, the microserver itself becomes lighter. It becomes smaller, which is great, because you know these images are like between 50 and 100 megabytes, and they eat memory. And like I said, I'm on the shoestring budget, so I want to have really, really optimized environment. But then I heard it's version 0.6. And so last evening at the speaker reception, Bert Sutter is actually talking about Istio tomorrow. So if you're interested in this stuff, I'll definitely go to his session. They said like, well, 0.6, we've heard from some customers, you don't yet use it in production. It's not yet stable. They were expecting a version 1 this summer. So they like said, like, well, we strongly suggest you only use it next summer, basically. So it looks like I'm going to go back to traffic. Traffic does support Kubernetes, so I'll probably use Kubernetes and traffic together. And so now I know what I need to do next. I've got my staging, but now finally to finalize this product and get it in production, you know, I still just need a couple of weeks, and then I can go to bed and probably just smoke a joint and be happy of what I've done. That's it. Thank you very much.